How's everyone doing tonight? Good. Thank you for coming out. Welcome to our fifth annual lecture series. I just have a couple of short things to talk about, some housekeeping rules. If you have a cell phone, if you didn't mind putting it down to vibrate or off, please, that would be great. If you need the restrooms, they're out this door here, up the hallway on your right. Some light refreshments in the back, coffee, tea, and whatnot. Please be mindful of using the tongs. It's flu season, and we want to keep everyone safe and healthy. Like to invite everybody December 5th and 6th to our 27th annual open house. We get a thousand or two people through there. There's a lot of things to do, games for the kids, sing-alongs. You can see the flyer when it's up on our website probably in another week or so, Sean.
Yep.
Okay. In your folders, I don't put a lot in there, but one of the most important things that's in there is the survey. If you could fill that out, you can do it anonymously if you wish. You can put your name if you wish. Just leave it on the back table before you leave. Helps us next year for topics and for where to spend our advertising dollars. Also in the folder, we got a couple new products out that may be of interest to you. I don't know if anyone here is familiar with oregano, but we're compounding liposomal oregano now, which is an antibiotic, antifungal. It's used in conjunction with a number of other things to treat certain things. Also has some anti-parasitic value, and then also curcumin, which most people are familiar with. And then lastly, if you can hold your questions till the end, if possible, we're filming live. This is live streamed tonight on HCAM TV, so whoever's out in that universe can watch this. I'm going to pass this mic around at the end, so when you're asking questions that people at home can understand them. And for a few more short minutes, our general manager, Sean Stevens, is going to tell you about a couple of our new programs and then over at Hopkin and Drug, and then he'll introduce Dr. Blanchard. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Again, I'm Sean Stevens, the GM over at Hopkin and Drug. I just want to fire through a couple of our services in case folks aren't aware of them. First of all, it's flu season. We have flu shots available. They're free after insurance. Drop by anytime. There's no appointment needed. We'll have you in and out in 10 or 15 minutes. We also have shingles vaccine. We have the pneumonia vaccine available, and again, no appointment needed. We recently started a prescription delivery service that's free to Hopkinton and all the adjacent communities. You can inquire at the pharmacy regarding that service. We have a medication synchronization program, which allows patients to pick up their prescriptions only one time a month. You don't have to request refills. We can fill all your prescriptions the same time each month, like clockwork, and request any additional refills for you from your doctor. And lastly, we have recently started bubble packing, which is personalized bubble packing. As you can see right here, it says the medication, it says the date, morning, midday, evening, bedtime. It helps folks take their medications properly. It's great for caregivers. So if you're interested in any of these services, stop by the pharmacy. I can answer any questions about these services after the lecture. So that's all I have. Without any further ado, help me welcome Dr. Blanchard.
This is a very favorite subject of mine, and I love to talk about it because I do believe that the things that you often hear about hormone replacement therapy from supposed experts in the field, I think is completely wrong. You know, everything is, all the recommendations as far as hormones, as far as academic people, pretty unanimous. What they say is, well, hormone replacement increases breast cancer and doesn't prevent anything. So that the only use should be maybe a few years at the time of menopause if you have horrendous hot flashes and sweats. A few years after, yeah, then you should, and nobody should be on it after some, maybe age 60 or something like that. Now, I've been doing this for a lot of years. This is my 40th year in practice. I do a lot of hormone replacement therapy, and I do a lot of it on women in their 60s and 70s, many of whom are professional women and could never handle their jobs if they weren't on hormone replacement. And the ones who come to me, in general, I don't do hormone replacement by itself, but if for patients who come to me because of hypothyroidism, which is my main specialty, since hypothyroidism often involves women in their 40s and 50s and 60s, so a lot of them also have menopausal hormone replacement problems. Now, the things that you hear, and it's kind of difficult if someone is a very famous physician and maybe they're Harvard Medical School or the big wheels in Boston, chiefs of services, and they keep saying these things, it's kind of hard to ignore it. I don't believe that it increases breast cancer risk at all. Now, they base this, now what they would say, what an academician would say is, well, the study showed, you remember 2002? It was in July of 2002, you turn on the evening news and the breathless reporter says, we used to think that hormones help women and help to prevent heart attacks because menstruating women don't get heart attacks. When they go into menopause, they quickly catch up to men. So obviously the hormones must be protective. So let's give them hormones. Well, this is an example of how lousy studies get done, mainly because of drug company money. Now, please don't go to your doctors or call your doctors tomorrow and said, you've been giving me Premarin and Dr. Blanchard says that that's poison. No, I started in practice in 1976 and I was impressed by how many women had been on Premarin for 10, 20 years. They looked good, they felt good, and I thought it was really great. And I prescribed a lot of it into the early to mid-90s. Now, at that time, the bioidentical estradiol became available. The early was the patches, Clymera, Estraderm were the first ones. And I, in general, when something new comes out, I like to try it and see if it works. Well, my feeling was that probably 80, 90% of women felt instantly better on transdermal estradiol than they did on Premarin. Now, Premarin has been around since the 1940s. The name comes from pregnant mare's urine, Premarin. It's a collection of horse estrogens collected from the urine of pregnant mares. It's a hell of a lot better than taking nothing. But those estrogens are natural in horses, not in humans. Hormones work by going into the system, they circulate to receptor sites, maybe in the brain and whatever, and they plug into receptor sites. You have to fit right into the receptor sites just right. Your own natural estradiol is what those receptor sites are for, and horse estrogens sort of do some of it, but they're not nearly as good. So first of all, I think virtually everyone gets better on transdermal estradiol. In the 90s, it was just the patches. Now we have various gels like Divigel and Estragel, and there are pluses and minuses to either way, but the bottom line is, I think that no one should be on oral estrogen, period. In the early to mid-90s, also, it became evident that when you take an oral estrogen, whether it's Premarin or even natural estradiol orally, oral estrogens going through the liver stimulate production of clotting factors. In the Women's Health Initiative, and here's where some of these scary numbers come from. The thing that grabbed the headlines in 2002 was, oh, hormones cause a 26% increased risk of breast cancer. Well, needless to say, the use of Premarin dropped off about two-thirds within a few months. Now, what they're actually saying, so this is the way academicians and lawyers and politicians can lie to you without exactly committing a lie. Now, what they did was they compared Prempro. See, Premarin is the estrogen and Pro is the Provera, the progestin that goes along with it. See, if you have a uterus in place, you cannot take estrogen by itself because it'll cause constant proliferation, hyperplasia, or even uterine cancer. But Prempro versus placebo. numbers were about 8,000. 8,000 women on Prempro versus 8,000 on placebo. This started in 1997, and it was in 2002 that they blew up the study and said it causes cancer and doesn't prevent anything. Now, what happened was that as of 2002, there were 38 breast cancers on Prempro and 30 on placebo. If you take 38 and divide by 30, you get 1.26. So from the statistician's point of view, what they said was if you take, quote, hormones, you have a 1.26 relative risk of breast cancer or a 26% increase, which of course sounds much worse. Now, in general, most of you are more afraid of breast cancer than you are of heart attack. But heart attack is 10 times as likely to kill you as breast cancer. This study was conceived of as a way of selling more Premarin if it could show a big reduction in heart attack. Because then they, you know, and of course, nowadays we're treated to this obscene business of pharmaceutical ads on TV. One other country in the world allows it, but in this country, the money of the advertising and the pharmaceutical industry, of course, carry the day and all our politicians give in to them. And so we get inundated. You know, ask your doctor if Cymbalta is right for you. It's horrible. If this study had worked and there was a big decrease in heart attack, can you imagine the number of Premarin commercials we would have seen by now? They would have spent billions. And of course, the drug company says, oh, we need high drug prices in this country because only one out of 200 or 300 drugs we study actually makes it to market, so there's a lot of research, a lot of research expenses. The fact is, they spend three times as much on promotion as they do on research. Anyway, now here's the thing. A difference of 8 cases in groups of 8,000 is not statistically significant. Not statistically significant. They acknowledged this in 2002, but they said it wasn't preventing heart attacks at 5 years. In fact, there were a few more heart attacks on Prempro than there were on placebo. So since it wasn't preventing heart attacks, there was no point in taking any chances that maybe this breast cancer risk would explode over time. So they canned the study at 5 years. The other half of this study with similar numbers was hysterectomized women with Premarin only versus placebo. That was allowed to go for 7 years. At the end of 7 years, the Premarin group had 23% less breast cancer than the placebo. Not statistically significant. I mean, you couldn't say, oh, let's give Premarin to prevent breast cancer, because that wouldn't work. That study was aborted at 7 years because there was a slight increased risk of stroke on Premarin. Well, you know, if you're giving something that increases clotting factors in the blood, you're more clotty. Well, I mean, you use large numbers. It would be surprising if they didn't have an increased risk of stroke. It was small, but that's why they canned that part of it at 7 years. Now, Wyeth Ayrst got a real kick in the shins with this because their sales went way off. Surprisingly, there's still a lot of Premarin being prescribed today. I don't understand it. I haven't prescribed it in 20 years. It's better than nothing, so please don't tell your doctor you're poisoning me with Premarin, because it's better than nothing. However, I think most women feel better on transdermal estradiol. So, now, the ways of giving it, some doctors use compounded estradiol from compounding pharmacies. I don't, because I think that the estradiol preparations that the pharmacists make up in a cream, if you apply it at night, you get blood levels that go up for a few hours and then go down. And when you're going down in the wee hours of the morning, that's not good for your sleep. The transdermal patches and gels, the commercial gels like Estragel, have very, very steady blood levels, which is much, much better, much more physiologic. Because a lot of the symptoms of related to estradiol levels are related to drops in estradiol. And many of you will probably remember that when you got to 45 or 48 and you started to have little symptoms of impending menopause, those things are related due to the fact that you normally have very high levels of estradiol pretty much through the whole cycle. When you get to about 45, your cycles become anovulatory, mostly. And the ovaries will still make estrogen, but instead of long periods of high estrogen, it becomes kind of spotty. And so this often comes up when we have patients 48, and she says, can you check my hormones, because I'm wondering if I'm going into menopause. I usually won't do it, because their estradiol levels might be 150 one day and 40 the next because of this spiking thing. Here's another way of looking at the risk as far as estradiol is concerned. Now, this is what happens. If this is a typical cycle, day 1 to 28, and let's say you have 3 or 4 days of flow here, and this is the estradiol level. The estradiol is normally very low at the time of menopause, goes way up like this. At the time of ovulation, around day 15, there's a little dip, and then there's usually another rise, and then a very sharp drop leading up to the next cycle. This is why some women will get migraines premenstrually. I'm sure some of you have had that experience where when you get a migraine, you know your period's coming the next day or two, and it's because of the sharpness of that drop. This is one of my favorite little tricks, because the women who do get migraines in here, I have them put an estradiol patch here, and so instead of doing this, they just do this. And they don't get migraines anymore, and it's so much better than using those triptan drugs. Average level for a menstruating woman is about 200. Here's where you are in menopause, around 10. You lose 95% of your estradiol when you go into menopause, so it's not surprising that you have a lot of symptoms. It's a very important hormone with receptor sites all over the body and the brain and so forth. Now, what my experience has been, when a woman comes to me and she's, I'm seeing her primarily for thyroid, but when this occurs, and her estradiol is 10, if I give her a patch or a gel and raise her to 30, 35, new person, just like that. That gives you a blood level of about 1/5 or 1/6 of the blood level that you had for 30 years of your life. So it's not exactly scientific, but it's kind of hard to realize that this is what the facts are. How is giving someone a level of 30 going to cause breast cancer or anything else? I believe it does not at all. I've gotten to 40 years without a lawsuit or a disciplinary action by the board, so I think I'm doing things right. And the thing is, it changes women's lives. But now, if you're new in menopause at 50, 52, and so forth, and your uterus is in place, you have to be cycled with progesterone. Prometrium is the old form of it, very sedating, so you have to take it at night. I give it 12 days a month, first 12 days of every month. Usually when you're 50, 52, you will flow at the end of that. You go on like that for a year or two, and then pretty soon you nothing happens when you take the Prometrium. What that means is that you're not proliferating the lining much anymore, and especially if the Prometrium is bothersome. A fair number of women get horrendously depressed and irritable when they take progesterone, like they have terrible PMS. Although I think half, 2/3 don't notice anything, except it is very sedating, so it must be taken at night. Once you start to see absence of flow, then it's safe to go to a lower dose of progesterone and take it every night, which is usually very, very much appreciated because of the sleep benefit of progesterone. Also, the idea, the bone density, I think there's no question at all. The long-term answer to osteoporosis is hormone replacement therapy. And to me, it's sad to see some of these women who are 70 or 80 and they're hunched over like this and 6 inches shorter than they used to be, because this is totally preventable. The answer is not those crappy drugs that they advertise on TV, bone density. Those drugs are horrible drugs, mainly beneficial to the bottom lines of the drug industry and the actors who portray, oh, how wonderful this drug is. But bone quality, it makes numbers on bone density tests look better, but the bone quality is questionable. The oral things, there's question about damage to the esophagus. I suppose if I had a patient who was frankly osteoporotic and already had a couple of fractures, I guess I would go for the intravenous bisphosphonate, this reclassed stuff. Presumably it doesn't bother the esophagus. Transdermal progesterone is something that I do use a lot of. But you cannot use that early on when you first start on hormone replacement because the levels that you get with transdermal are very, very low. It can be very helpful in women in their late 40s who are still cycling, but they're starting to get more PMS and heavier flow and clotting, menorrhagia. And that's probably because at around age 45 is when you stop, you may not ovulate. After that, it's just hit or miss. And always keep in mind that even if you're 50 and you haven't had periods for a couple of years, it's still, you know, 1 in a million chance you could still get pregnant with a late surprise. Because every once in a while, you might pop off an egg, you know, one straggler might get away. That's about it. But in general, you have to use the oral progesterone to initiate hormone replacement therapy safely. Now, the standard preparations, Permetrium, fortunately now there's a generic that seems to be okay, so the cost is a little lower. The official ones are made with peanut oil, so one always has to ask about peanut allergy with commercial progesterone. Now, at Hopkinton Drug and other places, they can make progesterone with olive oil, which certainly sounds a lot nicer and probably is a lot nicer. And plus, we can also customize that, maybe use 50 milligrams instead of 100. The initial treatment with cycling has to be 200 milligrams every night for 12 days out of every month. For reasons I've never quite understood, many women who go on that start getting their period about day 9. The theory is that as long as the progesterone level is high, the uterine lining is still kind of ripening up, and when you stop it and the level falls, and it's like pulling the rug out from under it and the thing falls apart. But I don't understand why that happens, but a fair number of women do start their flow at day 9 or 10, in which case there's probably no point in taking the last couple of progesterones. Testosterone. I do a lot of testosterone. Now, a fair number of women who go into menopause with all their plumbing intact, you know, no hysterectomies, no partial hysterectomy, anything like that, so that everything is still intact, most of them still make a fair amount of their own testosterone, even many years into menopause. And if you knew maybe your mother or grandmother, a neighbor, knowing a woman who was 80 or 90, and never been on any hormones, you know, you notice how a lot of them will have almost male pattern balding and whiskers. Now, the reason for that is that they've been running on empty with estradiol for 30 or 40 years, but the testosterone has been maintained to some degree, so that there's an estrogen-testosterone imbalance that leads to that. It's not all bad, because testosterone is good for your bone density and good for your brain function. As far as the general subject of hormone replacement therapy, I don't do it routinely, but if women have had hysterectomies with removal of ovaries, chances are, if you measure testosterone, they're all running on empty. Then the question is there a good reason to use it? To me, the reasons are, I have zero libido, and that's not too popular at home. It'll help some. Stress incontinence. Now, stress incontinence is where you leak urine with a cough or a sneeze, and that happens because the sphincter muscle under the bladder weakens, and so it can't hold up to the stress of a cough or sneeze. Testosterone is a magic bullet for that. If you had a bone density reading that was kind of scary, I think that's an automatic reason for going on testosterone. And if you are low on testosterone, just getting it up to normal female levels often helps with general vigor, mental sharpness. You know, if you've got a profession that you have to compete in, or, you know, to get things done, it helps. It's nice to have a little testosterone. So I do it. If you pick a dose of testosterone and a woman notices it little, getting a little oily, maybe a zit, maybe a little hair growth, and it just says the dose is too high, but it doesn't mean that testosterone is no good. And I don't ever see any serious problems with it. You're not going to get a beard or acne if it's done properly. As far as, let's see, what else? Now, since you all hopefully picked up those packages I want you to write individual questions, because I hate talks with slides and so forth and canned talks. I like to keep things spontaneous. I'm trying to think of a few more things I might want to say, but otherwise, I'd like you to write your questions down, and we'll collect them, and then I'll just address individual questions. Sleep quality, mood, bone density, general well-being. You notice Premarin commercials say estrogen must not be used to prevent coronary disease or dementia. It does help to prevent those things. You realize that we've long known that any age group you study of people with dementia, 70 to 75, 80 to 85, women outnumber men 2 to 1. Now, they used to say, oh, that's because a lot of men get heart attacks, and so there's predominantly women as you get older. But in fact, the numbers are too disparate. And I think some open-minded researchers are reopening the idea that maybe it has something to do with that women's hormones just drop like that. Men undergo menopause where they peter out a little bit. That probably is the difference. I mean, the patients that I treat are amazed that in their 60s, even 70s, how well they function. And then they say, oh, all my friends who are not on it, I can't believe what a difference it makes. Well, what happens if you get breast cancer 5 years later? I'm not seeing it, but of course, you know, mine is just a tiny sliver of the general population. And sometimes I think that because I run a specialty practice, I don't take insurance, that I think I'm skimming the more health-conscious women who take good care of themselves, keep their weight down, eat the right nutrition, take supplements, and so forth. But I just don't believe that it increases the risk of breast cancer at all. But what if you do get breast cancer? I don't think it prevents breast cancer, so that if I do it with hundreds of women, every once in a while somebody gets breast cancer. In fact, one patient that I had in my practice for a number of years developed breast cancer about 10 years ago. I had her on hormone replacement. She disappeared from the practice. And every day I'd look at the mail trembling, thinking, oh, there's an envelope from Dewey, Cheatham & Howe that she's suing me for. But she didn't, and she came back a few years later. They said, oh, you must not be on any estrogen. Well, her life was so miserable that I put her on the lowest patch, 0.025 patch. She's with me today. She never sued me. And she feels so much better. And again, if she's running at levels of 8 or 10, you give a little bit of estradiol and make them 20 or even 20 or 25. New people. Now, if you took a woman who was menstruating and averaging 200 and suddenly made her 20, she'd be very, very unhappy. Such as after, say there was a terrible infection in the uterus or some reason that she had a hysterectomy at age 38. Well, if that woman is not, and the ovaries removed also, if that woman is not pre-medicated with an estradiol patch, I guarantee you, you're going to have a crazy patient in the hospital just going absolutely berserk because the drop is too sharp. You know, many of you are probably, you know, some of you have had this experience or you know of women who've, who are 60, 65, never took anything, and they've done fine. Well, I'd say just like with Premarin, if you're doing fine, I say leave it alone. Only if there's a strong reason. If there's a tremendous sleep disturbance, mood disturbance, severe osteoporosis, these are reasons for going on. Mike, I think we could collect the questions. I hope there are plenty of questions when you deal with this subject.
I also have a mic here. If people want to ask from their seat, they can take this mic.
Well, I'll see what the questions are on paper. And sometimes people are reluctant to get up and Oh. Well, here's one. How does hypothyroidism coordinate with HRT? Well, usually I don't take patients simply for hormone replacement therapy, but for hypothyroidism, and if they need hormone replacement, I do it. All I can say is if they come in with untreated or poorly treated hypothyroidism and they're also running on empty with their hormones, they really turn into new people after I get them regulated. It's just a matter of trying to maintain homeostasis. Now, this brings up a philosophical question. I don't know if any of you are familiar with Dr. Susan Love, but she's someone who's was a big breast surgeon. I don't know if it's many years ago. Maybe she's, I don't know if she's still with us, but she wrote many years ago that, and she was kind of a bitter person, I think. She said, hormone replacement therapy is something concocted by male doctors and their buddies in the pharmaceutical industry in order to control women patients. I mean, that's almost laughable to say that. You could make a case that, well, why interfere with Mother Nature? Isn't menopause natural? Are doctors and pharmaceutical companies turning a natural process into a disease so that we can treat it and control patients? Well, if somebody wants to just be in menopause and have the symptoms of menopause, I'm not going to be twisting any arms. But when it disrupts your life, my feeling is you do it. Don't we all? I mean, to me, it's almost like saying, well, if you get pneumococcal pneumonia, well, let nature play its course. Maybe you go through a crisis like in the old movies, and people sweat their brains out, and then they survive. Well, most people will say, give me the antibiotics, because I'd like this to go away. So we interfere with Mother Nature all the time. I personally believe that this is a good way to go. And, okay, start. Yeah, here's something that always colder than other people. Coldness. To me, I mean, you always think of hypothyroidism because metabolism is slow, so you're not generating enough heat. And some of you may be aware of this old idea that you can diagnose hypothyroidism by just collecting basal body temperatures. Some guy, Rhoda Barnes, wrote this about 50 years ago, that you just collect basal body temperatures, and if all of them are like under 96, that diagnoses hypothyroidism. Now, there may be something to it. Of course, it's poo-pooed by professors who say all you do is you get a TSH test, and that tells you yes or no. But when I see patients like that, even when they are feeling remarkably better physically and mentally, you know, if they were going along at 96, they don't go up to 98.6. They'll increase a degree or so. So if something is better, coldness sort of implies that somehow at cellular level you're not generating enough energy. Thyroid is part of it, but it's not the only thing. So I discourage people thinking they're going to be 98.6. Starting osteoporosis, you know, osteoporosis because of loss of your hormones, basically. Certainly if you... you know, if you take your vitamin D and calcium and so forth and exercise a lot, that helps. Can't sleep that well. Of course, a million things can affect sleep. But if somebody comes in and says they have a horrendous sleep problem and they're running on empty with estradiol, my feeling is you give it and see. Because if you can solve a sleep problem that way, isn't that infinitely better than taking drugs to put you to sleep? Because you get habituated to them. After a while, they don't work so well. Doctor gets nervous about, this is a class 3 drug, I'm afraid of getting under scrutiny for over-prescribing drugs. It's not a healthy sleep. What are my feelings about CIRM? I think that's the CIRM drugs are the, like Avista, that sort of act like estrogens, but they're not really estrogens. If somebody wants to try them for symptomatic relief, I don't really prescribe it. I think to me, there's no substitute for your own natural estradiol and your testosterone and your progesterone. Vaginal dryness. When you go through 30 or 35 years of your life, averaging a blood level of about 175 to 200, and then you drop to 10 because of menopause, the vaginal tissue becomes raw and dry, intercourse is painful. In general, even if you take a pretty good slug of transdermal estradiol, you're never going to get up to 150 blood levels. Typically, women are 40, 30, 40, 50, even on the highest patch or a good slug of estradiol gel. So if your systemic estradiol levels are running about a quarter of what they used to, you can understand how at vaginal tissue level there may not be enough estrogen. And for that, there are various preparations. I generally tend to use Vagifem, which is an applicator, like a little tube. You insert it, when you press the button, it releases a tablet of estradiol high in the vaginal vault. And that works pretty well. The thing is, what it does is it gives you a high local level of estradiol, which is what you need for the tissues to feel healthy. There is some systemic absorption of that, but even in women with estrogen-sensitive breast cancer, where of course the oncologist would like to have your estradiol level be zero, even though you'll feel like you're about 200 years old if your estradiol level is ever zero, they usually will okay the Vagifem. Because if your blood level was 10 on nothing and you use Vagifem, it might be 12 or 13. Now, if you get breast cancer back, only a lawyer can tell you for sure if it was the Vagifem. Something, I've had two popular books on hypothyroidism, and the 2004 book has a philosophical statement that I thought when I wrote this, I was going to be famous, it was going to be quoted in textbooks, but nobody's quoted it except me. I was talking about how complicated human beings are and what a mountain of often conflicting data we deal with in medicine. And I said, the only people who have 100% answers to anything in medicine are medical students, malpractice lawyers, and well-compensated expert witnesses. You know, all the rest of us are dealing with percentages and probabilities and coin flips and educated guesses. Here's a question about prescription therapies for hot flashes or vaginal dryness that don't have any hormones. I have no experience with that. I'd be kind of skeptical that that anything without hormones would have any benefit. A representative of one of the pharmaceutical companies came in and gave me was pushing something called Brizdel. Oh, this is a way of handling hot flashes and sweats that's non-hormonal. And then you look at the fine print, it's paroxetine. You know, Paxil, the antidepressant, but at very low dose. My feeling is that any woman you put on SSRIs, these antidepressant drugs, they're disgusted with it a year or two later and they're plus 20 pounds. I've never prescribed it. If somebody wants to try it, they can, but I wouldn't prescribe it. Huh. Here's the ultimate question. Can't lose weight, what would you do for it? I think in one of the previous talks I've given, somebody asked that, a woman got up and said, what can I do to lose weight? My answer was, you know, if I had a great answer for that, I wouldn't be going fishing in a 19-foot boat that's 30 years old. I don't know. When I do thyroid, there's nothing automatic about weight loss when you go on thyroid. In fact, I think many individuals are gaining weight because of their thyroid, because every time they tell their doctor, I think I'm tired and I'm gaining weight, they said, well, let's try more thyroid. Maybe that'll help. And see, when you do that, the T4 levels go above the optimum point and you push TSH down to zero. This is a recipe for continued weight gain rather than loss. Who can we go to for testing for hormones? How about Dr. Dopelt there in the pink? Now, she does a lot of this stuff, and I can certainly recommend her. When the tests show there is, quote, nothing wrong, how do you get the doctor to treat functionally for high thyroid? Well, I think there are a few doctors who do what I do. Supposedly, if the question of thyroid comes up and your doctor follows the book, How to Practice Medicine for Dummies, he'll say, you get a TSH test, it's normal up to 4 or something like that. Ugh, you were 3.8, I can't treat you. If we only had a 4.1, I could treat you. Now, this is really what I call connect the dots type medicine, because we know from studies where volunteers have indwelling catheters so you can draw a TSH every hour, and you do these studies, you see your TSH is bouncing around all day long like that. So, or sometimes they'll say, oh, I had a 4.1, and my doctor said, gee, I think you have it, but let's check it in 3 months. Oh, 3.7, it was a false alarm. You might have had 3.7 the next hour. The other funny thing about TSH, that fortunately nobody's getting thyroid tests done at night or in the evening hours, but 2 hours before your biological clock says you're going to sleep, everybody's TSH goes way up. In other words, if you had a 2 or 2.5 during the day, if somebody happened to draw it at 11 o'clock, say you were in an emergency room because you banged your knee up, and you said, I'm seeing a thyroid doctor next week, can you draw a thyroid test so I don't have to get stuck again? Well, the TSH might come back 10, in which case your doctor will say, ooh, you just developed hypothyroidism. No, it's part of biorhythms. Many things get higher during sleep. It's part of our biorhythms, part of our rejuvenation process. When the brain raises TSH, it's approaching sleep. What that does is it gives the thyroid gland the message, release more thyroid hormone. Your body wants more thyroid during sleep. The same thing happens with melatonin, growth hormone, and testosterone. All of these are part of our body's rejuvenation process, these hormones that are higher at night. For that reason, I always give progesterone and testosterone at night. The other reason is that testosterone levels are so low in women in general, especially in menopausal women, that if you apply testosterone to the skin and you go to the lab 2 hours later, the levels come back that I look at, I think, oh my God, women with beards and lawyers showing up, because you'd be sky high, because you know it's such a small, there's so little in the blood that the day's dose really raises the ante. So if you apply it at night, by the next day, it's sort of leveled off, so the testosterone levels mean something. Talk about the interactions of hormone replacement with the thyroid. See, so many things depend on our hormones, and sometimes I think that one of the fundamental problems of aging is our loss of hormones. Now, I'm not saying go on hormone replacement, you're going to be young forever, but I must say the women who've been on hormone replacement therapy for 20 years, even if it's Premarin, they look a hell of a lot better than women who've been running on nothing. How we feel depends on many things coming into final common pathways. So if your thyroid is way off, you can do all sorts of things with hormone, and it doesn't work. Or if the hormones are way off, you can do all sorts of stuff with thyroid, and it won't work. In fact, when patients call up, I don't take patients until they submit me a little summary of what's going on, why they want to come and see me. And if it's a woman who's around 50 or 52, and she says, well, she's tired a lot, she had a history of PMS, infertility, sleep disturbance, and sleep is the thing that bothers her the most. She cannot sleep, it's horrendous. Whatever she does, she can't sleep. Now, I call those women up and I say, do you have a strong feeling about hormone replacement therapy? Now, if the answer is, oh my God, I don't want to get breast cancer, I would never take that, then I don't take the patient, because what happens is I can fiddle with her thyroid. She might get a little bit better, but she calls me every week saying, I had another sleepless night, it must be my thyroid. And meanwhile, she's running on empty with estradiol. You know, you go through all these years of averaging 200, now you're 5 or 10. You got to fix that. Now, if somebody can be down that low and have no problems at all as a result of it, I say leave it alone. if you're okay and your bone density is not a problem and you're sleeping okay, go ahead. Discuss the epidemic of hypothyroidism. Now, according to academicians, there is no epidemic of hypothyroidism. It affects 3-5% of the population. And here, let me show you with that. See, the TSH test is regarded as an absolute yes or no answer. One of the golden rules of medicine. You think she's hypothyroid, get a TSH. If it's normal, tell her it's not her thyroid. And this comes down to the basic things of how do we know? How do we know what is the normal level of anything? Well, you have to have an assay that measures whatever it is you want to measure, and then you do it in a large number of people. So this would be the number of patients, and this is the TSH. So I say 1, 5, something like that, 10. Well, as many of you know, a typical TSH is like 1 or 2 or 3 or something like that. So what happens is if you take 500 women, sign up for the test, and say, do you have a thyroid? Do you go to a doctor? Yes. Did the doctor ever tell you you had a thyroid problem? No. Okay, you're normal. Well, that could be a woman with chronic fatigue, PMS, depression, the whole bit, and missing out her eyebrows, puffy face, in other words, have like an H painted on her forehead, but she's never been told she doesn't have hypothyroid. She will be included in this as a, quote, normal. So what do? You measure all these women, plot it like this. So with levels of 2 or 3, a lot of people are up there. There's only a few down here, a few down here. You get a bell-shaped curve. The textbooks say that hypothyroidism affects 5% of the population. Oh, well, great. Since this is an absolute test, you just chop out the middle 90%, and that's so-called normal. So, and then individual labs do this, and suppose they say normal in our lab is 0.38 to 4.17. This is totally meaningless. If someone comes to me with a strong clinical picture of hypothyroidism, I treat them, and I don't care if their TSH is 1. Now, I do that realizing that if they had a heart attack and died a month later, I'd be sued and I would lose the lawsuit. However, I've never had a lawsuit because a therapeutic trial of thyroid is utterly benign. The only thing that matters if you have a strong clinical picture of hypothyroidism, you do a therapeutic trial, conservative dosage, does she respond or doesn't she? That's the functional approach. That's the title of my 2012 book, The Functional Approach to Hypothyroidism. Michael, you have we're always gone. Oh, even if you don't have the microphone, anything else? Yeah. Oh, good. I'm glad you brought that up. There are three natural estrogens in the body, and they're abbreviated E1, E2, E3. Now, this is estrone, this is estradiol, and this is estriol. Now, there is a school of thought that says that estriol, because it is a weak estrogen, gives you the benefit of estrogen without the risk of breast cancer, or it may block receptor sites so the bad estrogen can't get in there and cause breast cancer. You know, there's a lot of use of this out there. It certainly sounds nice. In my use of it, I've always been disappointed with the results of doing it. So I never prescribe it. If somebody comes in and they're on Triest and they like it, I'll do it, but very, very rare. I don't think there's anything to this. For the symptoms and the things that you're trying to treat, you have to get your own natural estradiol into those receptor sites. That's what your body wants. Again, if you're at 10 and you get up to 30, you're 1/5 or 1/7 of the blood level that you had for 30 years. I don't believe it causes any problems at all. I do believe it helps to prevent dementia, coronary disease, no question about osteoporosis, no question about sleep disturbance. And of course, if you have a chronic sleep problem, I mean, everything falls apart if you can't ever get good quality sleep. So, yeah, in the back there.
Yes, if you are on your protocol for osteoporosis and you stop the drugs, stop the hormones, does your bone level plummet the same as it would if you were on drugs?
Yeah, it probably would. But to me, that's, you know, you might say, well, you know, if it does that, then why do it in the first place? Well, why eat if you're just going to get hungry if you stop eating? You know, I think, you know, most of us would like to have optimal health. I think most people don't care whether they live to 85 or 90, but when they're 60, 70, 80, they want to be able to do things and feel normal. In my opinion, if a woman gets to 50 and has impending menopause, and her goal in life is to be as vigorous, intact, mentally and physically for as long as possible, I think she should be on hormone replacement therapy.
Yeah. What's the drop-off age?
The drop-off?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, meaning you can take hormones. If you live to be 100, you can take them at the age of 95, 98.
Well, the thing is, nobody's ever been there before. You think you're going to be 100? Well, it must be about 45 years, I would think.
Pardon me?
Must be about 45 years until you get to 100? Yeah, see, I don't, in reality, there's no way to know that. In fact, you know, breast cancer increases with age just like most cancers do. And, you know, if estrogen was a major factor, you'd think that, well, if a woman gets to 70 and she's been running on empty for 15 years, she ought to be home free. Because there's no estrogen around to stimulate breast cancer, but in fact, breast cancer just increases with age. Now, there's a lot of biological variation. There's estrogen-dependent breast cancer. In general, the things that have no estrogen receptors, whatever, tend to be the more malignant, invasive types. So there's another factor that if there's any increased risk of breast cancer on hormone replacement, it tends to be the more benign, manageable breast cancers. Having said that, only a lawyer can tell you for sure if your breast cancer was caused by estrogen. Yeah.
I promise I'll show
you. Boy, you're full of questions. Good, because I'm running low here.
Okay, thyroid. If a person is thyroidless and they're on a good dose of AM meds, I noticed you said that.
A good dose of what?
A good dose of thyroid med, a high dose in the morning. And that's what they need to sustain themselves. Can you possibly take that dose in the morning, cut it in half, and take some at night so that you would lower your TSH at 10.
No, see, what you're talking about, the standard replacement therapy for hypothyroidism is the T4 hormone, Synthroid, Levoxyl, whatever. Now, I've made a very nice career out of also using the T3 hormone. It is controversial. If you're really into that subject, you need to get my book, The Functional Approach to Hypothyroidism. Because, see, the academicians continue to this day to insist that all you need is 100% T4 because, boys and girls, T4 converts to T3 in the body. That's why you don't need it. Now, in my opinion, they're wrong on 80% of the patients that they see. And if somebody's had a thyroidectomy, my God, it's 98% because the normal human thyroid secretes about 95.5 T4, T3. If you've had ablation of your thyroid by surgery or radioactive iodine, you're not making any T3 at all. So those individuals with thyroid ablation who are given 100% T4, about 99% of them are miserable for the rest of their lives. Now, they can be going to chiefs at Harvard Medical School hospitals and be told, T4 is the treatment, that's it. You're on plenty of thyroid. Oh, you're tired and you're gaining weight and you can't think and you can't sleep. It's not thyroid because you're on thyroid and your numbers are normal. Well, those individuals often just grow new lives on T3, but you know, you have to know how to do it. The literature is out there. There's 6 studies from about 10 years ago that took T4 patients, randomized them to T3 or placebo, and all 6 said T3 makes people worse rather than better. Now, the problem with the studies is that they used T3 at doses 10 to 20 times the appropriate dose.
Okay.
See, the T3 hormone has been around since 1960. Cytomel was the original trade name. When they brought it out in sizes of 5, 25, and 50 micrograms. So it sounds like 5 micrograms is low-dose T3. It's about 4 times the average dose that I give in my practice, which I can do because of the compounding wizardry at places like Hopkinton Drug, where I can dial up 0.0001 milligram if I want, because they can do anything. And when you do it that way, people turn into new people. Oh, well, yeah. But see, the ultimate thing in terms of how you feel, when you say, how do you feel? Well, you're talking about your energy, your cognitive function, your sleep quality, you know, just general well-being. Mood is okay. What that does is it depends on the balance between T4 and T3 at the level of cells, your tissue. We can measure T3 and T4 in the blood, which is all we can measure, but that's not what's happening at tissue level. When you take a T3 pill, T3 levels can go up and down 50 to 80%, but it's not that you get energetic and then you're hypo again at the end of the day. You know, a lot of times people say, well, couldn't I take like half in the morning and half in the afternoon so I can have energy late in the day? I'll say, go, let's try it. Except what I want you to do is try it for a few weeks, then take both in the morning and see if you see any difference. They still get tired in the afternoon. Because it's not a matter of the blood level, it's what's happening at tissue level. Now, what's happening at tissue level depends not just on how much T4 and T3 is coming in the bloodstream, going to your cells, but it also depends on the conversion of T4 to T3 and T3 to T2 and T1 at cellular level. Well, that's somewhat dependent on TSH. That's the other not talked about function of TSH. The main function is thyroid stimulating hormone, stimulates the thyroid to release more hormone. So that if your brain says, hey, we're not getting enough thyroid, puts out more TSH, come on, let's go thyroid, make more. But TSH drives that conversion enzyme. So paradoxically, if you keep complaining of being tired and gaining weight, your doctor says, well, let's give you more thyroid, and then you get your numbers back, your T4 is above normal and your TSH is zero. Well, the tests say that you're hyper, but in fact, clinically, you're hypo because you've turned down that conversion at cellular level. Now, that is a situation that I call the black hole, because once TSH is feedback suppressed down to zero by too much thyroid, if you back way off on the thyroid, it stays stuck for many, many months. So if you try to go off it, you feel even worse. Oh, let's go back on it. It's a horrible position to be in, so I think it's very, very important never to overdose with thyroid and push the TSH down to zero. I think there are people, and you see this in people who've had Graves' disease, where they were very hyper and the TSH is always zero. Well, you correct it, maybe with radioactive iodine, maybe with methimazole or propylthiouracil. Numbers are normal, people feel better, and 6 months later, the TSH is still zero, even though the T4 and T3 have come way, way down, and that's because of this phenomenon of getting stuck at zero. So it's very, very important not to get overdosed with thyroid, because it puts you in the black hole. You know, this happens a lot with people who undergo go on HCG or growth hormone to lose a lot of weight. And I mean, you know what the history is with people who lose a lot of weight in a hurry. They gain it back in a hurry. You know, you lose 30 pounds over 6 months, almost 100% of those people are plus 33 6 months later. Gee, why is that? Why don't they just stop eating so they don't gain weight? T4 stores in fat tissue. When you start dieting, you put T4 back into the circulation so you can push your T4 up and push the TSH down. Well, technically, the tests say that you're getting hyper. In fact, as you ratchet TSH down, you're slowing the metabolic rate, which causes people to plateau. Suppose you had been dieting for 20 weeks and you lost a pound every week. Well, the standard wisdom is, well, that's 500 calories a day or 3,500 calories a week. So if you're losing 1 pound a week, hey, just liberalize 500 calories and you just go sideways. No, you go right back up the hill, almost 100%. And the reason is that you've shut your metabolism off, the conversion off at cellular level with a TSH of zero. Once you stop dieting, the flow of thyroid hormone out of fat tissue into your system stops. Once you start gaining even a few pounds, the flow reverses. The reforming fat tissue is sucking up thyroid hormone like crazy, leaving you hypometabolic at cellular level. So if you lost 30 pounds and 3 weeks later you were plus 15 and you felt like you were 100 years old, if the doctor tests you and say, oh, your TSH is still zero, you're still hyper. No, you're desperately hypothyroid. Unfortunately, there's no simple answer to that. The T3 hormone does help to some degree, but it takes months and months and months to get the TSH unstuck so that you can get back to normal.
Is that information in your book?
Yeah, I talk about that in the book.
Can I have the name of the title of the book again, please?
It's called The Functional Approach to Hypothyroidism. Actually, I think they sell it at Hopkinton Drug.
Okay.
Maybe the only store that's also, you know, it's done pretty well as a book. But my favorite chapter is chapter 5. And I thought I was inspired to write this. T3 or not T3, that is the question. And I talked about these 6 studies where they gave 10 to 20 times the appropriate dose of T3. Gee, T3 did worse than the placebo, so obviously T3 makes people worse. See, it's like lawyers and politicians. They're telling a lie, but not exactly committing a lie, because the T3 people did get worse. Well, it's because they gave too much. See, all the hormones depend on an ideal level. You can feel lousy because you're too low. You take too much, you can also feel lousy there. And when you're on Synthroid alone and feeling tired and gaining weight, and then they say take more, it actually makes things a little bit worse.
I notice you're not mentioning Armour, Naturethroid, any of them.
Well, see, Armour, Naturethroid, Westroid are all derivatives of pig thyroid. Now, see, this is the preparation that goes back over 100 years from pig thyroids. It's called Armour because it originated in the Armour packing plant in Chicago where they isolated hormones from the pig thyroids. Now, it turns out the natural mixture has everything that's present in a pig thyroid, and it turns out that it's about 80% T4, 20% T3. Now, the normal human secretion is about 95.5. So the whole idea is you're not juicing people up pharmacologically with thyroid. It's physiologic. You're replacing a deficit. For the huge majority of people, you can't replace a 95.5 secretion with an 80-20 mixture with Armour. And that's the problem with Armour. Now, those of you who read a lot, read all these natural websites and so forth, they say, oh, Armour, that's the way to treat hypothyroidism. It's so much better than synthetic. Some of you might be familiar with a very forgettable book by a Dr. Sanford Siegel entitled, Is Your Thyroid Making You Fat? Well, according to Dr. Siegel, smart doctors like him give Armour and everybody is thin and happy, and the dumb doctors who give synthetics, all their patients are fat and unhappy. If it worked, I'd be happy to do it. But again, it's putting an 80-20 mixture into your body. The only thing that's important is what kind of T4-T3 ratio you wind up with at tissue level. There are a few people, maybe 10%, who can be fine on Armour forever. And if you're fine on Armour, if you feel good and your numbers look good, I'd say keep doing it. But for too many people, they become relatively deficient at tissue level of T4 because they keep replacing a 95.5 secretion with an 80-20 mixture. But the typical thing is you put someone on Armour, ask them a month later, and they think it's a miracle. Lost 5 or 10 pounds without even dieting, feeling better than they ever have. The problem is that the T4 saturation in the tissues is gradually declining. When it gets to it, because you start with 100 times as much T4 as T3, for a while the T4 is okay and not becoming a problem, but you have that extra T3, so you feel great, lose weight and everything. When the T4 becomes depleted, people fall off a cliff. I've had many, many patients come to me on Armour. They always remember how great they felt at first, and eventually, gee, it stopped working. And if a doctor says, well, let's give you a little more, it further pushes you into the black hole of T4 depletion. T4 depletion is one of the chapters in my book. Yeah.
Would you comment on patients who've had thyroidectomy in terms of treatment with thyroid replacement?
Yeah. Well, see, thyroidectomies are being done much more commonly now. Thyroid cancer is The diagnosis of thyroid cancer, I think, over the last 20 years has tripled, the diagnosis of cancer. However, the death rate from cancer, thyroid cancer, has not changed at all. And basically what that says is now because we ultrasound people at the drop of a hat, we're finding little nodules that if we never found them, they would be, they're what we call incidentalomas. If you start imaging, so, you know, sometimes people have an MRI because of sinusitis, and they say, gee, that low cut shows that you have a thyroid nodule. You think, nodule, oh my God, what if it's cancer? Well, fortunately, a neck ultrasound at least doesn't expose you to any radiation. And the radiologists have gotten so good at thyroid nodules, they can tell you down to a millimeter of the size of it. So if you see a nodule, you just repeat it in a year. If it stays stable, you don't worry about it. But the thing is that since the normal human secretion contains about 5% T3, to my opinion, I never thought I would see a thyroidectomy patient who felt well on 100% T4. Until my daughter-in-law had a thyroidectomy about 3 or 4 years ago, and she has done very well on 100% T4, but she's in her 30s. She was a varsity soccer player at Providence, and she runs a lot. If you exercise a lot, it enhances your own internal T4, T3 conversion. She does fine, but people who are on 100% T4, especially with the complaint of brain fog, depression, sleep disturbance, that says they're deficient in T3 at cellular level in the brain. Somebody did a genetic study about 6-7 years ago on like 500 and some patients and found that about 15% of the population has a genetic deficiency for the deiodinase type 2 enzyme. Now, deiodinase type 1 is the thing that converts T4 to T3 in most of the tissues in the body. Deiodinase type 2 is specific to the brain. So these people who are deficient in the DIO2 enzyme, you give them T4, they're absolutely dead hypothyroid at brain level. Now the cynic in me, at one time I read this study, I said, sooner or later some entrepreneur is going to make a buck out of this and offer the new super high-tech test for the genetic test for, it costs $1,000. People say, well, I want it. Well, as long as it's covered by insurance. And in my opinion, totally, utterly unnecessary. Because the only thing that matters is if you have brain fog, you're on 100% T4, and your lab numbers look like you're in perfect balance, the only question is, what's the proper amount of T3 to give with that amount of T4? In that circumstance, you give it, and 95%+ of people, a couple of days, turn into new people. And if that happens, see, that's why I called my book The Functional Approach to Hypothyroidism. I don't even do T3, total T3, free T3, reverse T3. It's all a waste of money. Doctors who do that don't even know what to do with the results of that test. Oh, they think, well, or else they order 1 million tests and hope that something kicks into the abnormal column. And then when it says T3 is 80 to 160, ooh, 78, and then you put a circle around it and see, that's what it is. We'll give you T3 and you're going to feel great. Then they'll proceed to give 5 or 10 times as much. Patients will feel great for a few days or a week or two, and then they'll feel worse than they were before. And then where do you go? They're in the black hole, relatively T4 depleted. Yes. Yep.
Just a little continuation of a question. Do you recommend that a person who's had a thyroidectomy have the appropriate dose of T4 to suppress the TSH down to zero?
Yeah. See, if people have had thyroid cancer, in theory, thyroid cells are responsive to TSH. So if you do a thyroidectomy and don't adequately replace thyroid hormone, the TSH will appropriately go way up. In theory, if there were a few residual cancer cells, it might stimulate the cancer cells. So in general, after thyroidectomies, it's felt to be good practice to keep the TSH down in the low end of normal. Now the thing is, if you keep somebody's TSH in the low end of normal, well, if the TSH is low, you're not going to have adequate conversion of T4 to T3 at cellular level. So my feeling is that very, very few people are ever feel well again on 100% T4. And giving them more never solves the problem because it'll even grind down the conversion to T3 even more. they may, if they slip up on their dosage and their TSH creeps up to 3 or 4, say, oh my God, it's going to cause recurrence of thyroid cancer. Probably not. This is something that's been taught for decades. It makes a lot of sense. And if a doctor has been taught, well, you keep TSH down because you might have recurrence of thyroid cancer, and then you realize if you keep somebody at a TSH of 0.1 or 0.2, they feel lousy. The other aspects of their lives are lousy. Maybe I'll let them go up a little bit. Then you think, oh my God, she gets thyroid cancer 4 years later, dials 1-800-SCUMBAG, and he knows for sure it was caused by the doctor not fulfilled. So they'll keep the TSH low. You know, it's like everything else. You know, it's a multifactorial thing. Nobody has all the answers. I think I have a lot of answers, but I know very well that I don't know everything that I should know. You chew the best you can. At the end of the day, you go home, have a drink, have a nice dinner, forget about it. Yeah. Boy, you're full of questions.
Mm-hmm. What does T1 and T2 do in the body? Any idea?
I don't think there's any official word that it does anything. Now, here's something I can, let me show you this. In my previous life, I taught organic chemistry at Vassar. And let me show you what goes on with the thyroid in terms of the hormone itself. That was when it was all female. I went there single. I noticed this cute little number sitting there. She always wore a tennis dress, and she had really nice legs.
Married her.
Yeah, I married her. Well, this summer will be 50 years. So, anyway, she admitted later that she always wore a tennis dress to my class, even though she never played tennis. Now, this is the structure of the T4 hormone. Now this is the major hormone. 3,5-3'5' tetraiodothyronine is the official term. But this is T4. Once this is synthesized in the body, the deiodinase type 1 enzyme clips one iodine off the outer, this is the outer ring because this is the one with the side chain. This is the active T3 with one iodine on the outer ring. Now, because of different positions on the molecule, this is three different iodines. So there's three different T2s. You can lose any one of these iodines. Now, if the second iodine to be lost is this one, so that you have 3,5-diiodothyronine, this T2 is active in humans, especially in the brain. And this is why I don't use pure synthetic T3. I use natural thyroid extract, the same stuff that they use in Armour, but I have them compounded. I started this with Dennis at Hopkinton Drug many years ago. It's given me a wonderful practice. I love what I do. I'm busy as I can possibly be. I had them put the natural extract, the natural pig mixture, in a compounded capsule. And when I figured it out to give people the same dose of T4, the same dose of T3 as when they were on pure synthetic T3, everybody felt better on the natural product, presumably because of this T2. Now, if you read a lot about thyroid, you'll also read about reverse T3. Yeah. Now, reverse T3 occurs when the deiodinase type 3 enzyme clips it off the inner ring. Once you lose it off here, this is completely inactive. And any of the subsequent ones you lose, everything's inactive. So once it goes to reverse T3, the activity is gonzo. Now, some of you may have any of you ever read Wilson's book, the Wilson Syndrome book? Yeah, don't bother. It's a piece of garbage. But basically, it's a book that was printed in 1991. A guy named Dennis Wilson, And he has this theory. He modestly called it Wilson's syndrome after himself. His theory was that because reverse T3 is completely inactive, but it's enough like regular T3 that it would block the receptor sites, so the T3 and T4 that you have couldn't get to receptor sites, that people could be hypothyroid because of too much reverse T3. Well, see, this is derived from T4. So his theory was, if you give pharmacologic doses of T3, and I mean, he's talking about 20, 30, 40 times as much T3 as I use in a balanced preparation, you would shut off TSH down to zero. Well, if you do that, you're suppressing the secretion of 95.5 T4 to T3. And so as T4 drops like that, there's no way you can form reverse T3. Well, his book, and yeah, so you might want to, just for laughs, to read this book. It's 1991, called Wilson's Syndrome, because I don't think it's dead yet. There's still people out there talking about Wilson's syndrome. Now, in fact, what happens is when you give pharmacologic doses of T3, you start suppressing the production of T4. Well, fine, as long as you still have a full body complement of T4. So when you get the extra T3, his book has 20 to 25 pages of glowing testimonial letters. Thank you, Dr. Wilson, it's a miracle. I've lost 20 pounds the first month. I wasn't even dieting. I feel better than I have in years. Keep up the good work. There are dozens of letters in his book. He's showing off with that. And I don't think he's made those up. The problem is that these people eventually become so incredibly T4 depleted, they absolutely fall off a cliff. Now, when someone does this, and I don't know if any of you ever saw, I'm always paranoid that somebody's going to make up something bad about me and put it on the internet. I haven't seen anything, but there was a doctor in Colorado a number of years ago who wrote a nasty article really attacking me personally. He said, Dr. Kenneth Blanchard's false beliefs about T3. I forget his name, but I think he's deceased since then. But he wrote that on his website that everybody in his family had a history of chronic fatigue and depression. A father and a brother both committed suicide, and he felt like that all his life until a smart doctor gave him T3. And he's been on T3 ever since, and he's feeling great. Couldn't do a simple math problem as a kid. Now he does math logic exercises just for fun. And he said, I'm 62, and I'll challenge Dr. Blanchard to a foot race up the side of a mountain. So I wrote back to him. I wasn't facile with email at the time, so I just wrote him a regular letter, which he never answered. I said, you're 62 and you want a road race. I don't think my knees are up to it. Maybe if I get my other knee done, it will be. But I said, but at the time I was 68, I think, or 69. I said, I'm still rowing crew races, so I'm not doing too bad either. And in fact, you know, it's actually possible. We could both be right. What if in the general sweep and the general population, there's a certain rare genetic variant such that somebody's metabolism is such that they can run in a sustained way on 100% T3 and continue to do great? Well, these are the people, when their primary docs give them 100% T4 and they fail, then they go to an alternative doctor, they give him, so that doctor gives armor and they fail, they come to me and I do my mixture and I fail. See, this is the end of the funnel. If there's 1% of people out there who have this kind of metabolism, they fail everywhere else, so they accumulate in doctors who do this T3 thing. Now, from their point of view, they say, look, there's 15 people coming in today. They've been on T3 for years, and look, they're doing great, doing great, doing great. See, obviously, this is the way to treat hypothyroidism. What's not being said are the hundreds and thousands of people who fell off a cliff and never came back. And if somebody doesn't show up for their appointment, they'll rationalize and say, oh yeah, she doesn't want to pay, you know, travel and pay our fees and so forth. She must have just got her local doctor to write for T3. No. I've seen a number of people who've gone through the Wilson regimen. They are basket cases. The last one I saw was over 300 pounds. She had a hard time getting up and walking into my office from the waiting room. But she remembers, she went on the Wilson regimen, lost 20 or 30 pounds, felt great for several months. But the degree of T4 depletion is just astounding after a while. And these people are in deep, deep doo-doo. Very difficult to get them out. You have to, and I've had, you know, the average dose of T3 in my practice is about 1.2 micrograms. In comparison, thyroid pills are generally made 25 to about 200 micrograms. 90 to 100 is perfectly reasonable. Maybe the single most common pill is 100 micrograms of Synthroid, the yellow pill. This is another thing that I do. I only use the 50 microgram pills because those dyes all contain aluminum. We should not be using pills with dyes. If you're on the 100 microgram T4, you're getting yellow dye number 6 and yellow dye number 10. These all contain aluminum. You may have chronic nasal allergy from the dyes that you're taking. And if I mention this, somebody comes in on 100 of Synthroid and asks, oh, chronic nasal, oh yeah, I have to do Flonase every night. And I say, let's try you on the dye-free pills. And well, I was told I was allergic to dust mites in my mattress. Well, my answer is the dust mites will still be there a week from now, but if the nasal congestion promptly clears up in about 4 or 5 days, getting rid of those dyes, that kind of tells you what it is. Yeah, you had a question?
Yes. What about using supplements for supporting thyroid, like iodine and vitamin C and magnesium?
Well, I think that, you know, I was trained in the 70s, and, you know, one of the classic stories, like a medical school graduation, it's graduation day, everybody's happy, and the eminent dean comes out and says, congratulations, good luck in your internships, and by the way, half of what you learned in medical school is wrong, and you're challenged now, go out and find out which half. Now, one of the things that we were taught that I think is totally erroneous is that you cannot be iodine deficient in this country. That's why we have iodized salt. Well, there's a degree of truth to that. I think you can't be grossly iodine deficient. But the bottom line is the Japanese diet has 20 or 30 times as much iodine because of seaweed and kelp. And basically, the Japs are healthier than we are. I think, you know, a lot of times I'll get women who are maybe 50 or so, and once they see what happens to them, they say, you know, I think I felt a lot of this when I was a teenager. This is better than I've felt in my entire adult life. See, I have a 15-year-old daughter. She's tired all the time. Even though she's tired, her sleep is terribly disrupted. She'll start to fall asleep and then jerk herself awake like this. Falls asleep in class. She used to be a super student. Now she has to work hard because her focus and concentration is no good. She only has her period every 2 or 3 months. When she gets her period, she has horrible cramps and PMS, so she's out of school for a few days. She's always walking around like this because she's cold all the time. And plus, she's very bitchy, especially at the time of her period. Maybe a little hair loss, sleep disturbance. And now notice her eyebrows are kind of thin. Well, this is the picture of hypothyroidism in a teenage girl. I can guarantee you that routine thyroid tests will rule it out every single time. Now, what I do in a case like that, especially because the sleep disturbance can respond so quickly, my usual thing, especially if she's like 80 or 90 pounds, is to use a preparation called Tyrosint because it's available in a 13 microgram size. The pills only come in 25 as the lowest, and that has a yellow dye in it. So I only use the 50, so trying to like use a quarter of a pill is impractical, but Tyrosint comes in a 13. To me, I say, take one of these at dinner time starting tonight. I would say it's at least 90% of them wake up the next day feeling like that's the best night's sleep they had in years. Well, if they're teenagers, not many years, but best that they've had in quite a while. They get dramatically better. Now, I think that those girls, if they were to take an iodine supplement, since I think all the kids grow up relatively iodine deficient, that maybe even the amount of iodine in one of those thyroid support things that's got, you know, tyrosine is the amino acid precursor, and maybe 100, 150 micrograms of potassium iodide. Those girls who are so borderline like that, maybe after a year of that, What I would do, and I don't have numbers, but I've done this a few times with some degree of success, since they get better right away on T4, I leave them on T4 for the school year, but have them take the iodine supplement as well, and then when it's the end of the school year, have them go off the T4. Now, I've done that with a few patients, and I never saw them again, so either they got cured or they changed doctors, but my gut feeling is that once you supply this, and you know, I also, you know, I usually tell people that if you like, you know, I don't know if you've seen these toasted seaweed things that they have in the store now. I've tried them. I don't think I would eat them just for fun, but I gave some to my daughter-in-law because I thought my three grandchildren, she makes them a fruit smoothie every day. I said, throw a couple of sheets of the seaweed in there. I think it would make an enormous difference in the mental and physical development of kids if they had this. Now, the recommended daily allowance is 100 micrograms. 100 micrograms of iodine. 150 for pregnant women. Now, my gut feeling is that that's way below what it should be. Just like when somebody says all you need is 1,000 units of vitamin D. They are tragically wrong for the huge majority of people. 4,000 or 5,000 is my average. I probably have 25 people on 10,000. I take 6,000. Nothing bad happens, but an awful lot of good things happen with vitamin D. And some of you may have heard authorities recently saying, don't get caught up in the vitamin D craze. All you need is 1,000. And I think, what kind of idiot would make a statement like that? And then I found out, gee, it's the chief of nutrition at Harvard Medical School. Well, gee, maybe I'm doing something wrong, but I've been doing it for so many years, all I see is good things happening with that. So I think it's pretty hard to go wrong with vitamin D. Everybody is deficient in vitamin D unless you're taking a supplement. Take it, it does a world of good. You know, when people, I don't know if any of you have had the experience of feeling down and out and achy and stiff in the winter in February, and then you go to Florida for a week, a couple of days in the sun, oh my God, all your aches and pains go away, you feel great. Oh, it must be the cold versus the heat. No, when you're running on empty with vitamin D, exposure to sun, you take a dramatic increase in vitamin D. Now, if you were of typical vitamin D levels, they say ideal is maybe 50 to 80. A lot of people run 20, 30, even in the teenage, even in the teens. And somebody once brought a young man, I guess he was about 16, to me. These people were from Boca Raton. And the kid was lethargic. He couldn't do a damn thing. And so they thought he must be hypothyroid. And I think most doctors would criticize me saying that I overdiagnose hypothyroidism, that I see it where it doesn't exist. But with this kid, I went over him and I couldn't find the slightest indication to me. It's looking for things like missing outer eyebrows. Nothing. No goiter. No reflexes were perfectly normal. I just didn't think this kid was hypothyroid. Fortunately, I'd measured a vitamin D level and it was 7. Well, even though the kid was from Boca Raton, he was going to Phillips Academy and spending all day in front of a computer. So I gave him, what I did was I put him on a loading dose. I don't know if you've ever been given this, but in general, if you have a very low level of vitamin D, because it's fat soluble, what is the proper thing is to give amazing overdoses for a month, you know, 50,000 a week for 4, 5, 6 weeks, something like that, and then maybe see how you do on 2,000 a day. So I gave them the regimen to do that. And I said, if he turns into a new person in a month or two, then don't come back. Well, he never came back. So I assume it did that. But you know, the thing is, these hormones all come to final common pathways so that it could be that extreme vitamin D deficiency, you know, you might look in a book and say, geez, sounds like I'm hypothyroid. You have to get, everything has to be working together. When you work on all cylinders, you can feel great. Yeah.
Have you diagnosed and treated patients who have had a T4 antibody and treating with T4 was ineffective?
Well, yeah, the question about antibodies comes up. My feeling is that all a doctor can do with respect to thyroid is to supplement the hormone that's being inadequately produced. Now, if you have positive thyroid peroxidase antibodies, technically you have Hashimoto's disease. I don't do the test. Because I have a thing that it drives me crazy when I see doctors over-ordering. They order every test known to man, hoping that something's going to pop up abnormal and give them an easy answer. There's nothing that you can do to make the thyroid antibodies go away. The only thing that matters is if that autoimmune reaction is causing you to be deficient in thyroid hormone, in which case you just supplement to make things normal. So that I don't order the test, and I kind of disregard it. I don't follow it at all. My feeling is the only thing the antibody test does is it allows you to tell people at a cocktail party that you have Hashimoto's disease. It doesn't affect what a doctor does. So to me, I don't do anything different with somebody who's positive versus somebody who's negative. So I think it's a wasted test.
I was asking specifically a patient who had T4 antibodies binding up the T4 that they were consuming, and they were in a state of hypothyroidism.
Well, now you're getting into real fine print stuff, and I don't do anything with that. To me, the only thing that matters is I'll keep playing around with doses of T4 and T3. Does somebody get better or don't they? If they don't get better, I tell them, go to somebody else because I don't seem to have the answer for you. And the idea that you have antibodies and that may keep you the hormone from acting, it's possible. But to me, that's medical school professor stuff, fine print stuff that is not really a practical issue for the most part. Yeah.
You had said if you lose like a pound a week for like 20 weeks, you tend to bounce back afterwards. Is there any hope? Is there like a rate at which you can lose weight and keep it off?
Well, this is getting off a little bit more into the thyroid, but that's all right. I love thyroid too. See, when you start losing weight, you put stored T4 back into the circulation, so you tend to get higher T4s and you tend to suppress TSH. This is something that I think has some future, maybe for somebody else to work out the details. But my feeling is that if you're on thyroid and you start to lose weight for whatever reason, you go on some special diet or something, I have patients do an official weigh-in every week. If they have lost 1 pound or more the previous week, I have them skip one day of T4. If they're on a T3 preparation, most of them are, that's just one a day all the way through. But the idea is to keep the T4 from going up and pushing the TSH down. Now, I have had some success, but I can't say huge numbers. This is one patient. I wish I had more patients like this, even though she's a lawyer. It's a woman who started at 220. She's now about 150. There are a lot of patients in my practice who, they look back 2 or 3 years later and they say, oh, this has made such a world of difference. This has changed my life. How come I'm -2 pounds or +2 pounds? It's because you can't dial up somebody's weight by just giving thyroid or giving more. It's tempting because T3 is the direct acting hormone. Say, oh, give more T3, that way you burn more calories and have more weight loss. But in fact, everything depends on balance. You can feel just as lousy here as you are here. And those studies that say T3 doesn't work, they put people up here and said, oh, gee, look at that. They did worse on T3. Well, I could have told them that before the study. You have to get things just right. The studies use 6 to 25 micrograms of T3 a day. 6 to 25. 1.2 is my average dose. Probably have maybe a few over 2, but that's about it. You don't get extra benefit by just taking more hormone. There's an optimum point above it. A lot of the same things come back as below. You try to overdose people with either T4 or T3 or both. Many times they get hungry. And if they get hungry and start eating, of course, they gain weight. And you know the old saying, I don't know if they do it at Hopkins and Drug, but a lot of places will automatically put a sticker on every thyroid preparation that says, take first thing in the morning and wait 1 hour before you eat anything. Well, T4 sitting in the stomach for an hour by itself, you realize that has never happened in the evolution of the human race, except in the last 100 years of taking oral thyroid. For many people, when they do that, they get hungry and they gain weight. It's probably a direct effect of thyroid hormone on the walls of the stomach. See, that's not part of normal body physiology. Because I've treated myself for thyroid for 30 or 40 years now, whenever I get ideas, I try it on myself first. And just in case there's a time bomb, I don't want people getting adverse effects and dialing 1-800-SCUMBAG because I'd be crucified. One thing I thought, well, since thyroid hormone in the stomach seems to stimulate appetite and weight gain, probably because of effects on obscure hormones called leptin and ghrelin, which have to do with appetite and weight control in humans. All I know is, I've seen many people over the years say, I've been on thyroid for 5 years and I'm plus 30 pounds. I'm hungry at night, so I eat. As soon as they take it with food, the hungers are gone, first day. It's a direct effect in the walls of the stomach. Now, the academicians recommend this because if you do wait with an empty stomach, you maximize absorption. I say, so what? If you get 80% absorption on an empty stomach and waiting, if you take it with breakfast and you get 60%, but you lose that appetite and your weight is better, my feeling is as long as you always absorb 60%, we just adjust the dose to you at 60%. Just take it the same way all the time. This business of take it on an empty stomach and wait 1 hour. You know, many times people say, well, since I have to go to the bathroom at 3 o'clock in the morning, I keep my Synthroid in there so I can take it, and that way I don't have to wait to eat breakfast in the morning. And wow, I need to eat breakfast because I'm ravenously hungry. Well, again, thyroid hormone sitting in an empty stomach is not part of normal body physiology. Now, I'd like to say, they all lose that weight. No, they don't. Yeah.
So if you're not on thyroid meds and you're losing weight and your T4 is going up and affecting your TSH, what can you do to support that without having
that's something hormones? I hadn't thought about before. Maybe some of these things where you diet for a week and then you go off for a week, it may be a way of edging yourself down without causing that imbalance. There probably is something to it. Well, you know, whatever the diet, there are a few people who had success with it, but, you know, so many times a new diet comes out, they sell a bunch of books, and 2 years later you say, whatever happened to the ba-ba-ba-da-up diet? See, when it first comes out, nobody's failed on it yet. Everybody, at last, this looks like it's going to work. And when you go into it with enthusiasm, you can start to lose weight. But part of it is this thyroid imbalance caused by the weight loss. Well, as the old saying, if you lose it slowly, it's not as likely to come back. And I think that's very true, probably because you can keep yourself in thyroid balance. And it probably would not be a bad idea to even do a moratorium for a couple of weeks to make sure that everything's normalized, then try to go a little further. But these big swings, rapid weight loss always induces rapid weight regain. I don't know if there's ever been a single person who's ever gone on a drastic diet, lost 50 pounds in 6 months, and then stayed minus 50 pounds ever since. I don't think it's possible.
I know a lot of people that start losing weight and within days immediately pull their thyroid into the story because they start losing hair. They feel terrible, within 3 or 4 days.
Well, I don't know how to explain that because in theory you should be getting higher levels of thyroid hormone. I can't explain that. It's not something that I've seen in my experience, but you know, who knows, maybe something like that. Sometimes people find things, find out, you know, observe certain things in themselves. They think, that must not be thyroid. Like for instance, the first brand name was Synthroid. The second one was Levoxyl. If some of you are on Levoxyl, it's a little bow tie shaped pill. Synthroid, although it still is a big seller, maybe number one here and there, is the crappiest pill on the market because the makeup of that pill has acacia, povidone, and talc. And then all of them use the same color scheme with the dyes in everything except the 50s. Levoxyl does not have acacia, povidone, and talc. So by and large, to me, if somebody was given a month on Levoxyl, a month on Synthroid to compare, to me, 95% would pick Levoxyl. However, whenever I learn something important, there's always an index case, somebody who shows me something for the first time that I'd never seen before. A woman came to me a number of years ago, an older woman who was on 150 of Synthroid. Now, the 150 of Synthroid has a blue dye, which among all the dyes is probably the worst allergen of all. So I gave her three of the Levoxyl 50s, said, boy, you're going to feel much better. Never heard from her again. She was from Buffalo, but her daughter was local, and she came in a number of months later and said, you know, what happened to Mom? She developed this incredible shortness of breath. Her primaries put her through stress test and pulmonary function. It couldn't figure out what was happening. When she ran out of levoxyl, she went back to Synthroid. One day it was gone, just like that. It's something in the excipient materials in levoxyl. I think it's probably a 1% incidence, but when you find yourself feeling like you have to take a deep breath every so often, especially you try to go to sleep at night, can't fall asleep because you feel like you have to take a deep breath. If you're on levoxyl, if you just switch to Unithroid within 3 days, if you have a history like that, it's almost guaranteed you'll be much better. It's a difference in excipient materials. You know, all of these pills have package inserts with fine print. You can hardly read it without a magnifying glass. And the first part of the package insert lists the so-called inert materials, the excipient materials. You know, magnesium trisilicate, povidone is the most notorious of the excipient materials. Povidone is present in Synthroid, Levothroid, almost all the generics. And povidone, in my opinion, is a major cause of hair loss. And you look at the package insert of Synthroid from the 1950s, hair loss, possible side effect of Synthroid, because when they did initial trials, there was a lot of hair loss. Now, how many women are on Synthroid and going to dermatologists, taking skin, hair, and nails, biotin, wondering why they're losing hair? You just get rid of the povidone, and that usually solves the problem, although anything with regard to hair, you have to be thinking in terms of many months. Yeah.
I'm taking levothyroxine, which I guess is a generic.
Yeah.
If it's a bad generic, how do I get the doctor to prescribe not a generic?
Well, the doctor has to be willing to do it. I mean, I'm so adamant about it. Even when we can do these things electronically to local pharmacies, especially if it's a CVS pharmacy, we can put it in the order, specify no substitution, the patient still gets a generic anyway. Part of it is they're lazy. If they don't have the brand I want on hand, they give them the generic and say, oh, it's the same thing. But also, I think the profit margin is higher on the cheaper generics than it is on the brand name. But I specify Levoxyl or Unithroid adamantly, and especially if it's a CVS, I'll write it out the old-fashioned way on paper, and then on the bottom I'll put a great big N-O, underlines, arrows, exclamation mark, no substitution, so the pharmacist gets the idea I'm going to be threatening bodily harm if they don't get this pill. Now, Levoxyl, because Synthroid and Levoxyl are both big sellers, almost everybody carries those, but Unithroid is an obscure brand that I've only started using recently, but now it's my favorite, and so nobody carries Unithroid, so I always do it paper-wise and threaten them with bodily harm unless they order it. Because they'll tell you with a straight face, oh, we can't get that. The translation of that is it's not on our wholesaler's list, so I can just check it off. But they can get it. They just have to work at it a little bit. If they're lazy, they'll say we can't get it. That's why I specify no substitution, no uncertain terms, and tell patients, if they tell you you can't get it, just take the prescription, go to somewhere else. Especially if you go to a local pharmacy. The local pharmacies are all trying to survive against CVS and Walgreens, so they'll go the extra mile and they want people to be happy because they want to survive. And by and large, those are pretty reliable. They'll get it. Yep.
There's always a problem, I don't know, for you, but insurance companies now decide what they're going to cover and what they're not going to cover.
Yeah.
And I know I've had a lot of difficulty recently with bioidentical hormones,
yeah.
Unithyroid. You know, the insurance companies are dictating what patients are going to, you know, get covered
yeah.
by.
Well,
$400 versus $30, they want to get off of it because they can't afford it.
I don't know, Seal, if you've had any experience with the generic estradiol patch. You know, Mylan has a generic estradiol patch now. It's actually pretty good. My wife is on it, was on Minivel. I switched her to the...
Minivel, but it's mini. Some of the generics look like, you know, baseball.
Like blowout patches. Well, the thing was that the copay for Minival was $30, and this generic estradiol from Mylan was $8. You know, unfortunately, transdermal estradiol, by and large, cost has been an issue. It can get astronomical. I mean, something like Elestrin. Women love Elestrin, but it is so damned expensive. But with this generic patch, unless you have skin problems with the patch, this is what I'm using much more of now, is the generic estradiol patch. Well, you have to do it twice a week. Incidentally, I don't think it was you, but another gynecologist called me up. I was telling, you ever heard of the Tennessee Church Lady story?
No.
Well, I was at a conference about the patches once, and the doctor got up and said, oh, this twice, because they Climaro supposedly once a week. It never lasts a week, but so it's a lousy patch. I never prescribe it. But, oh, these twice a week patches, you know, you have to do it morning and night. You have to do it just right, and people get confused. They call up. The doctor from Tennessee got up, and he said, I'm from the Bible Belt, and I tell the ladies, every time you're getting ready for church, change your patch. So Sunday morning service and the Wednesday night church supper, so they do it that way. And the patient told her gynecologist, called me up and said, I love that Tennessee church lady story. I want to use that myself. Because, you know, it has to be changed twice a week. And if you go past 3.5 days, many times you will start to have little hot flashes and sweats if you forgot to change it. There is maybe a 15, 20% up and down, so it's not as steady as the gels. However, there's such a cost saving with... What's that?
They're not as messy as the gels.
Well, you know, the preparations are better. I don't know what... I think Estrasorb was a cream. God, that was sticking to people with staining clothes and everything. I gave up on that. But Elestrin, Estragel, Divigel, these things are all very, very good. Matter of fact, thanks to my favorite Estragel rep, I have a placebo sample, so I give them a squirt and they rub it in, and it's very nice. You know, just a minute, and you don't feel anything there. It's far, cosmetically, it's very nice. Except it is expensive, and cost is a big issue. I don't take anybody off bioidentical hormones because of age or because of number of years. I think they should be on it.
When you say expensive, how expensive?
Well, you know, it so much depends on your insurance, but, you know, $50, $80 a month copays are not unusual. Okay. Maybe even more. Like, especially Elestrin.
Then the insurance companies can say, well, it's not going to be covered by us.
And yeah, well,
that's a big problem.
I think, you know, I may have a slightly skewed practice because I don't take insurance. So generally, there are patients who are not, if they feel great, they don't care if it's $50 a month. But, you know, if you can do it, if there's no skin reaction to the patch, the Mylan generic patch seems to be working fine.
Start elderly people who become osteoporotic over time that were surgically menopausal and they've been without estrogen for 20 years and their internist tells them you will not be on estrogen because it'll cause you all these problems.
First thing I do and look and see if my malpractice is paid up.
Yeah.
Well, we can't always practice, defensively. We have to individualize to the patient, but, you know.
As far as the osteoporosis is concerned, you know, to me, it appears that estradiol does not increase bone density. It just helps to preserve what you have. So I wouldn't think of a 75-year-old with severe osteoporosis and giving them that, because I don't think it would do a hell of a lot of good. On the other hand, if she's running a level of 5 and running on empty, I might be tempted. Depends on whether I feel lucky. Because, you know, if she drops dead a month later and the family sues, I'm cooked.
In terms of dropping dead, do you see people with cardiac arrhythmias with thyroid issues, like AFib or...?
Yeah, well, the simple answer is if you give too much thyroid, it can cause atrial fibrillation. Now, in fact, again, this general principle of both T4 and T3 have optimal levels. You feel lousy here, you feel lousy there. If somebody here is having either irregular beats or frank AFib, closing that gap may actually normalize it. Now, dealing with cardiac things and potentially fatal things, I'm not as adventuresome as I am usually, but I think, you know, the gut feeling is if a patient develops AFib, and say, ah, the thyroid does it every time. I don't know. See, the idea is thyroid replacement therapy is physiologic, not pharmacologic. What that means is that if this is where you're supposed to be, the only reason to give it is because you're here, and the idea is to get you from here to here. If you say, oh, I'm still tired, I'm still gaining weight, let's try a little bit more. No, it doesn't work. This is the normal physiology. In general, I think by restoring normal physiology, I don't think it causes any kind of arrhythmias at all. But since arrhythmias happen here and there, somebody might get some kind of arrhythmia in connection with thyroid treatment. If there's any suggestion of overdose, then I would just have them stop it for a few days and resume it at a lower dose. Ah, the lady with all the questions. You're the lady with all the questions. Well, you're keeping us going.
That's why you're the lady leaving with all the answers, too.
Yeah.
Do you treat children?
I have taken them as young as 10. I'm not a pediatrician. I've never done pediatrics, so I tend to not want to get involved with kids that young. But usually what I would say is to the mother, is try giving her one of those thyroid essential supplements with tyrosine and a dose of iodine, or else have her see if she likes. I think you can find chips that are made with seaweed. Have her take an iodine supplement and see how she does, because maybe that little extra iodine will be the thing that kind of puts her over the hump and gets her into the sweet spot as far as thyroid is concerned, without getting into, because the testing, you might as well. You know that the TSH test is going to be normal, absolutely. And they can see the chief of endocrinology at Children's Hospital. They'll be told, absolutely, they're not hypothyroid at all.
What if their antibodies are up?
Well,
in 70s?
See, if they're, in a case like that, I think if there's positive antibodies and a clinical picture of hypothyroidism, it's certainly a little more justification for giving thyroid hormone. Guess what? Here's our major domo. Dennis tore himself away from compounding life-saving prescriptions at Hopkinton Drug, decides to join us for the last 5 minutes. By the way, what happened to the cookies? You getting cheap or something?
I haven't got time yet.
So, I don't know, usually about this time the natives get restless and they want us out of here. So, anyway. Okay. So who's got one more question? Yeah. Here's the man with all the questions.
How about the relationship between thyroid disease, if you will, or insufficiency, and ADH, ADHD?
Well, I think there is a real connection there. See, again, if a kid is struggles with focus and concentration, is a little hyperactive, certainly if you do thyroid tests, they're all going to be normal. If you give Ritalin, and I had one of my kids was given Ritalin twice, and at times we thought, oh yeah, Brian is better. Look at that. He's playing soccer. He's getting on the right side. Look, he's setting up for a cross. He's thinking two steps ahead. Boy, Ritalin does it every time. Bottom of the class to the top of the class. To me, if a kid is hypothyroid, they will have issues of focus and concentration. My feeling is, rather than, I wouldn't prescribe Ritalin, I leave that to other people, but I would give a kid like that a try on thyroid. Now, if you say, well, give a try on thyroid, if you give 100%, if you give them a trial on Synthroid, I can guarantee you it's not going to work, because this is a neurotransmitter problem at central nervous system level. These kids probably automatically need the T3 hormone. Now, I might give them something like 13 micrograms of tyrosine to just see if we got lucky, and maybe they happen to be good converters. The only thing that matters, and this is, you know, I mentioned the philosophical statement in my 2004 book, but the 2012 book, The Functional Approach to Hypothyroidism, starts with this immortal statement. The only thing that matters is, does it work or doesn't it work? If the kid is doing dramatically better, now I don't, maybe I've had a couple like this over the years. I don't have much experience with it, but I wouldn't have any qualms. I mean, compared to giving a kid Ritalin or Adderall, a therapeutic trial of thyroid is utterly benign compared to a class 2 controlled substance. And I mean, these are not dangerous drugs, but there's a real question. These stimulant drugs, I think, actually downregulate thyroid further. I think. But I don't have much experience with it. However, I would still give a therapeutic trial, including some T3, if such a kid were brought to me, but I'd probably try to weasel out of it, because I know that I don't have a good feeling that what I'm going to do is going to work. All right. Thank you for coming.
Well, I'm still struggling a little bit, but it stiffens up a lot when I'm in.